revelation of that which surges forth from the inner depths of the cosmic soul. Okay, so you have this correspondence between the cosmic soul and the individual soul. And the individual soul, it's there are Hindu elements from Hinduism in this too, because the goal of the individual soul that's separated from the cosmic soul has to be to recommunicate with the cosmic soul for fulfillment or oneness. Then I give another example from Klages, where he talks about the Urbild, or the original archaic image of the forest, as an example of the correspondence between cosmic and individual soul. Then I talk about his essay in 1926 on Bachofen, Benjamin's essay, and natural symbolism. Well, he calls Klages a great philosopher, and because he seeks to renew contact with realities of natural mythology that for millennia have been repressed by the conscious mind, which is kind of the enemy. And among these realities or actualities are the images, the bilder, by virtue of which, Benjamin says, by virtue of which a deeper, ecstatically constituted world penetrates the world of mechanical sensibility, using mankind as a medium. Images are souls, either of things or persons, souls from the distant past that form a world analogous to the dream consciousness of contemporary man, in which primitive consciousness receives image traces. So I think that paragraph, or these sentences from Benjamin's Bachofen essay, a review, it's very dense, but it reveals all the linkages between Klages' ideas and Benjamin's own conception of what's valuable about them. So then I go on to talk about the rise of irrationalism in European politics in the 1920s, and Benjamin is concerned about the fact that the Nazis in the 1930s are favorably disposed toward, or Nazi philosophers. Alfred Bäumler was the one of the official Nazi philosophers, a Nietzsche scholar, and also a Bachofen enthusiast, and he writes this book on the myth of the Orient and the Occident. And then, you know, Klages publishes Geist as Virus Aqua der Seele, the intellect is antagonist of the soul, and the anti-Semitic aspects are quite clear in this book, which goes back to the Habermas quote that Benjamin knew where his enemies lay. But there's also, I think, some interesting work on Bachofen, allusions to Bachofen in the history of Marxism that Benjamin certainly knew. And I talk about Marx's son-in-law, Paul Laforgue, who writes on matriarchy, but also Engels in respected early work on the origins of the family and private property, which where he celebrates Bachofen's theory of matriarchy as the example of a primitive classless society. Now, of course, the goal in Marxism is not to return to primitive communism, but to advance to a more economically developed and technologically successful state of equality. So this is the conundrum that Benjamin's facing in part. So I go on to page 14. At this point, it's worth inquiring about the dimension of Bachofen that Benjamin sought to recover. It pertained to matriarchy, prehistory, and classless society, as I was just saying. In Benjamin's view, Bachofen's path-breaking discovery concerned the correlation between prehistory and communism. Bachofen's breakthrough was to have identified the relationship between communism, primitive communism, and Mutterrecht, and matriarchy, or what Marx actually in the Paris manuscripts calls primitive communism. So, you know, we have this term, and it's used by modern feminism, in the West at least, gynocracy, ruled by women, and communism went hand in hand, supposedly. So, and Benjamin compliments Bachofen by saying that he had unearthed the undisputed fact, but it is disputed, that some matriarchal communities developed a democratic order and ideas of civic equality to a very high degree. And he compliments Clagas for the, as I say, the subtlety of his analyses and the depth of his insights and the level of discourse. So these are sincere compliments or elements of praise. So on these grounds, Benjamin viewed Bachofen's thinking about matriarchy and structural egalitarianism as infinitely valuable. It's just what he was looking for, just what he was needing to recapture this dimension of prehistory that's a key to the future. It's an antidote for the injustices of modern class society and modern industrialism and alienation. The difficulty, however, is to discover or figure out how one could actualize these potentials amid what I call the desolate landscape of modern technological civilization. How do you recover this primeval Eden or paradise in Bachofen? So this is where Clagas comes in, I think, and the notion of Urbilder or archaic images becomes an urgent concern. And Benjamin argues in the Arcades Project and elsewhere that these the traces of these Spuren, Bloch writes a book called Traces of these images, Bilder, remain preserved in the historical present. We have to identify them and rely on them to recapture this relationship to the archaic matriarchy or egalitarian side. So it's in the Arcades Project, I'm suggesting, which was never finished, of course. We only have, you know, kind of outtakes or fragments. But where Benjamin considered these methodological ideas very seriously. And the proof is in the Arcades exposé that he writes in 1935, which is probably the most replete or developed statement of what his intentions for the finished work would have been. So it's important that he starts off with this citation from Jules Michelet, the great French historian of the 19th century, who says, in French, chaque époque rêve la suivante. Each epoch dreams the one that follows, thereby implying that the past can serve as an anticipation of the future. Both the surrealists and Freud, for Benjamin, believed that dreams tell us more about reality and especially about the future. This is an old trope, that dreams can tell us about the future. They're clairvoyant, right? Like Bloch's notion of dreaming, Zukunftsträume, dreaming toward the future. Like the surrealist, for Benjamin, dreams possessed a higher cognitive value than traditional rational epistemology. They explode the reign of the reality principle that's repressing us, and they provide intimations of utopia. For this reason, in the Arcades exposé, which I'm talking about now, he also cites a famous remark from the young Marx from 1843 in a letter to his young Hegelian colleague, peer, Arnold Ruge, that it's a famous remark, yeah? The world has long been dreaming of something that it can possess in reality only if it becomes conscious of it. And Clagas says similar things in on dream consciousness in his book or essay. So then in the opening paragraph of the Arcades exposé, I think, or my argument is, that all these various figures, while there are only four terms or figures or ideas, come together, and Benjamin links them. The notion of wish image, in German it's Wunschbild or Wunschbilder, dream, collective unconscious, which is a term from Jung, C.J. Jung, Freud's antipode or opponent, and classless society. So here's the quotation from the Arcades exposé. Corresponding to the, and I think this is a genuine statement of what Benjamin wanted to do in this project. Corresponding to the form of the new means of production, are images in the collective consciousness in which the new is permeated with the old. These images are wish images. In them, the collective seeks both to overcome and transfigure the immaturity of the social product, capitalism, and the inadequacies in the social organization of production. These tendencies deflect the image fantasy, which is given impetus by the new, back upon the archaic past. So, and then the final citation I have from the Arcades Exposé and this significant discussion of the archaic images and the wish images. In the dream in which each epoch entertains images of its successor, the latter appears wedded to elements of archaic history, Urgeschichte, that is, to elements of a classless society, pure Bachofen. And the experiences of such a society, as stored in the collective unconscious, engender, through interpenetration with what is new, the utopia that has left its trace in a thousand configurations of life, from enduring edifices to passing fashions. So I think, without going into it, I think that this framework is very clearly relying on the types of ideas and discourse that Klages had expressed in Of Dream Consciousness from the early 20s and this book on cosmogonic eros. I think this really gave Benjamin a stimulus. But let me explain this then for the Arcades Project. The key to the Arcades Project hinges on a theory of images or Bilder that derives from Klages' notion of archaic images. The wish images of utopia or of a classless society have been deposited in humanity's collective unconscious. Such images derive from the archaic past or prehistory, and an allusion to this mythical era of matriarchal equality in Bachofen and in Klages. Under conditions of late capitalism, the old and the new commingle, and the archaic images from prehistory press forward in an attempt to surmount the deficiencies of industrial capitalism. According to Benjamin, these Klagian wish images are irrepressible. They emanate from the collective unconscious, and as he says, they leave their traces in a thousand configurations of life. Which are they? Iron constructions, daguerreotypes, bourgeois interiors, grand boulevards, and barricades. These are the central conceptual rubrics or folios, convolute in the Arcades Project as we know it. And this is, I think, the focus of his, Benjamin's, redemptive hermeneutics. This is the Habermas expression as well. So suffice it to say that in Benjamin's eyes, the utopian socialist Charles Fourier, and then I have this description, who believed that under socialism, rivers and lakes would be filled with lemonade. Sounds pretty good, actually. Public fountains would overflow with salmon, maybe already cooked, I don't know. Wells would yield champagne rather than groundwater, and men and women would learn to fly, and wild beasts would do our hunting for us. Was a better socialist than Marx. And of course, there is a, in the convolute of the Arcades Project, there's a long section of notes on Fourier. So I'll bring this to an end now. In Cosmogonic Eros, Klages contended that archaic images and dream life are parallel phenomena, and this gave Benjamin the stimulus to speculate about the type of resolution that I've been talking about between past and future. If wish images of the 19th century represented a type of collective dream, as Benjamin talks about the phantasmagoria, as Benjamin frequently claimed, then his Arcades Project was a monumental historical philosophical Traumdeutung. This is the title of Freud's famous work of 1900, Interpretation of Dreams. Freud's first work is a Freudian, really, in many respects. So in the Arcades Project, in this convolute or section on Dream City, Dream House, Dreams of the Future, Benjamin seeks to illustrate the relationship between archaic images and dream consciousness in classless society. He says that just as a sleeper's physical sensations, blood pressure, intestinal action, heartbeat, affect her dream imagery, the same is true for the dreaming collective. Just as when we're sleeping as individuals, our digestion influences the images of our dreams, this is true for humanity writ large. So we must, he continues, expound the 19th century in fashion, advertising, buildings as the outcome of dream visions. So this is the new configuration of nature that unleashed these Urbilder, archaic images, and the collective unconscious is a depository of world processes embedded in the structure of the brain and sympathetic to the sympathetic nervous system. So in Benjamin's view, Jung's account of the relationship between prehistory and human physiology complemented Klage's theory of what Klage calls the reality of images, Wirklichkeit der Bilder. Okay, reality of images. So you have to make the images come true, realize the images. So that's just a specification of the relationship between them. Then I have a couple of examples where Benjamin uses similar images and ideas from Klages. And then I talk about the Adorno-Benjamin debate very quickly on the Arcades exposé, where Adorno criticizes Benjamin's notion of prehistory as a golden age. Now, you see, Adorno's nervous. He's 9 years younger than Benjamin. But he's nervous because all this fascination with archaic images and prehistory in the archaic past is being embraced by reactionaries and fascists at the time. They don't want to go forward. Of course, they're very pro-technology, but they also have this kind of ideology about tradition and neo-primitivism, which is a prominent component. And that's why Adorno can't go there. And so he tries to point out that prehistory was not an idol with a Y-L-L, I-D-Y-L-L. It was not a utopia, but it was closer to Hobbes' notion of a life that is nasty, brutish, and short. So Benjamin tried to realize some of these ideas in his essay on Baudelaire, but it was rejected by the Institute for Social Research and Horkheimer. And actually, there's a long letter by Horkheimer that is very critical of Benjamin's attempt to utilize Klages and Jung for the Arcades project. And then you can see that I just mentioned in conclusion that Klages published this book in 1940 that was some early writings, Rhythms and Runen, which are runes, archaic signs, symbology, which are actually very popular nowadays among the European far right as well. They're especially in Scandinavia. They're fascinated with these great ancient gravestone carvings, which are known as runes, not ruins, runic writings, Stonehenge and elsewhere. So it's a return of the past that's disturbing. And Klages had released these writings in 1940, and they were very compromising. And I'll just mention, the last thing I'll mention as a coda is, and in part as an anticipation of my afternoon lecture, is I was working on this in Frankfurt on Main beginning in the late 1990s. And at the time, I was researching the bibliographies on Klages. And I noticed that Habermas had written an obituary. He was very young, Habermas, in 1956, so he's 27, on Klages, who had died that year. And the title of the obituary in the Frankfurt Allgemeine, which is the most prestigious German daily, was, I'll just translate it, Ludwig Klages, irrelevant, or bypassed, or still relevant. Obsolete, or still relevant. And the conclusion he reaches was that Klages was still relevant, and this was still important, that Klages was a significant thinker. And so this is my anecdote. So Habermas was, my mentor. I was a Humboldt fellow in Germany and worked on Heidegger with him. So we met for lunch, and I'd just come from the library. And I hadn't read the article yet. I just saw the title. And I said to him, I see you wrote an obituary for Klages in 1956. And usually he has a very good memory. And he said, no, I wrote it, but I never published it. And I kind of scratched my head and said, well, that's kind of strange because I see the listing in the bibliography. So I paged the article, and I still have it. It was a surprise to me because it was a very enthusiastic, not uncritical, but very supportive obituary for Klages. And by that time, I was back in New York, and I made a photocopy, and I sent it to Habermas and Starnberg, and I wrote on the top of the article, the obituary, "Your secret is safe with me." And so I'll just stop there. But thank you for listening, and I'd be happy to take questions or answer questions.